The 1950s and 60s are a period when American cultural texts systematically reach international audiences, and the role of the US state cultural foreign policy through institutions such as the Congress for Cultural Freedom has been extensively researched. And these institutions aimed to exercise soft power on the states that were under the US political and financial sphere during the Cold War, through the promotion of American culture and an American way of life, participating in a cultural Cold War. They also financed the edition of journals which promoted liberal ideas, such as in the case of Greece, Epochés, 1963-1967, and exchange programs. While the bibliography on the cultural Cold War is extensive, the reception of American culture in Greece has not been equally researched. Based mainly on the printed press, which is the most powerful and influential media in Greece at the time, and there are very few radio archives, I shall focus on the representations of American culture, the cultural products that were presented, translated and diffused in their reception. Due to the lack of time, I shall focus on periodicals of different types: popular periodicals, literary, and student periodicals. Before examining the reception of American culture in the cultural and literary field, strongly defined by Cold War politics, I should very shortly outline here some events that shaped these fields. You might be familiar, but I'll be very quick. As you may know, the Second World War in Greece was followed by a civil war between the left and the right, 1956 to 1959, which has been described as the first warm incident of the Cold War, ending in the defeat of the left. Although not all the supporters of the left were communists, in a polarized political climate, the Communist Party was outlawed in 1956. Its supporters and sympathizers were persecuted for decades, and the society was ruled by an alliance of nation-minded politicians, the church, and the armed forces. Nevertheless, in constitutional terms, Greece was a democracy, and it was closely dependent on its Western allies, both financially and militarily. In the early 1960s was a period of economic growth and relative political stability, during which demands for civil rights and political freedom became more outspoken. The backlash of political violence by the shadow state mechanisms culminated in the military dictatorship 1967-74, which was backed by the USA. The term Long 60s has been used by historians to describe the period from 1958, which is the period of destalinization, which influenced Greek politics. At the same year, there were elections where the party of the left came second in 58 to the end of the dictatorship in 74. During the Cold War, the reception of American culture was not uniform internationally, but it very much depended on the country's position vis-a-vis the Cold War power blocks. Therefore, it was very much political. Indicatively, in Greece, Sweden, and Japan, which bordered the Iron Curtain, the reception of American culture was very ambivalent. In the 1950s, it was connected to the presence of American armed forces and anti-communism. In the 1960s, the American consumeristic model, channeled through cinema and musical cultural industries, was promoted as a modernizing project on one hand, while American policies within these countries were received negatively. After the war in Vietnam, the concept of cultural imperialism highlighted the cultural hegemony of the USA and informed the international countercultural movement and the critique of capitalism and consumerism. Indicatively, the Chilean book, How to Read Donald Duck, criticized the colonial ideology promoted by the Disney comic. Nevertheless, the appropriation of these cultural texts are dynamic and depend on the characteristics of each country's cultural field. The cultural practices and identities associated with the receptions of these cultural texts can be creative, resisting the ideology promoted by the cultural industries and institutions. In the case of Greece, institutions such as the Congress for Cultural Freedom could not develop a lasting influence due to the peculiarities of the Greek political and cultural field. In the mid-1950s, the Cyprus issue, which was whether Cyprus, which was at the time a British colony, would be independent or annexed to Greece, triggered nationalist and anti-American discourses and feelings in both the center and the left against the government of the right. Moreover, de-Stalinization allowed some writers and intellectuals of the left to tentatively approach the liberal intellectuals and writers who gradually distanced themselves from the nation-minded right, especially after the 1958 elections and the backlash of anti-communist political practices. On the other hand, the American Armed Forces, the Voice of America radio station, Hollywood movies, students, visitors, and immigrants were the channels of the American popular culture, as was the case in other countries. American consumeristic model and pop culture was adopted by the Greek cinema and popular press and mainstream periodicals, not without moral panic in some cases. I shall shortly present how American culture is perceived in the magazine Tachydromos. It first appeared in 1954 as a weekly magazine. It belonged to the Labrakis publishing group, along with the prestigious newspapers Tovima and Tanea. And some years later, the heir of the publishing group, Christos Labrakis, his sister Lena Savidi, and his brother-in-law, the well-known philologist Yorgos Savidis, were involved in the editorial team. Tachydromos combined political commentary with socialite news, fashion, and literature. The presence of cultural text in the periodical is very closely associated with the political orientation of the magazine. In the 1950s, literature was published there was usually American popular fiction, such as crime stories by Dashiell Hammett and Raymond Chandler, or serialized women's fiction, such as Kathleen Windsor's Star Money. Following the popular magazine's practices, some translations were adaptations, as is the case in the comic you can see on the presentation. Stan Drake's comic, The Heart of Julian Jones, which is translated as The Greek Girl from and the American Girls, a contemporary social story from the life of American youth. And it is rewritten so as to include a Greek character who experiences the American way of life, and I quote, in Stillwater, Oklahoma, on the Pacific coast. She becomes popular due to the visit of the Greek royal couple to the USA. And here you can see the Greek and the American version. On the other hand, there are articles presenting the American way of life in terms of moral panic, especially concerning drug use and youth crime. Here is drug use on heroin, youth crime, teen criminals, and an article on what is wrong with America. The image of American culture presented in the period is rather stereotypic. A powerful country with different moral values and low culture, that is, an heterotopia. After Christos Labrakis and Yorgos Savidis joined the editorial team in 1958, the magazine acquires a more sophisticated profile. In terms of politics, the magazine is somewhat more critical towards the American policies and the American model. It presents cultural texts from the USSR, such as the movie And Quiet Flows the Dawn, or short stories by Maxim Gorky, or this one, where, and I read from the title, a Western diplomat, I fear the Soviet bookshops more than the Soviet missiles. So it is a cultural war. And an article about the fear of Americanization. On the other hand, contemporary American literature is translated systematically, promoting a richer image of American culture. J.D. Salinger, Scott Fitzgerald, Truman Capote, Tennessee Williams, William Faulkner, and James Cain. It is interesting here that the Greek diner owner in The Postman Always Rings Twice becomes an Italian in this. It is adapted so as not to shock the public. There are short stories and novellas by critical, these are short stories and novellas by critically acclaimed writers, shaping a canon of American literature that subverts the stereotype of low American culture. Most of the texts employ realistic techniques and focus on an individual at odds with the norms of society, which is very different from the Greek one. In that way, American society is presented as a heterotopia to the Greek reader, especially concerning personal relations, which is in line with the magazine articles we saw above. Science fiction stories such as Ray Bradbury, Brian Peter, Howard Fast, or Finn O'Donovan are also translated, some of which are atomic war dystopias, criticizing the Cold War atomic rivalry. In that way, science fiction short stories are more politically, in a way, than those of the canonical writers presented above. Some of these short stories are translated in tachydromos immediately after their publication in US magazines, as is the case with the stories by Finn O'Donovan, this one, John Updike, Irving Shaw, William Faulkner, and Truman Capote, the Breakfast at Tiffany's, or his novel. These were originally published in the magazine of fantasy and science fiction, Galaxy, Esquire, and The New Yorker. And following the model of these American magazines, the texts are illustrated by well-known or young promising artists and translated by prominent writers which worked for the magazine. Although they are writers from other countries translated in the magazines, in tachydromos, American literature is dominant. As the 1963 elections approach, which led to the first government of the center after decades, tachydromos published much less American literature and much more Greek literature, thus turning the ship towards a more national-oriented approach. In 1964, there are real translations of American literature, while there are articles criticizing the poverty and social problems in the USA. On the other hand, there are articles by American feminists, such as Betty Friedan, The Feminine Mystique, or this is another one, The Sick Giant, about criticism of American society, or Helen Brown, Sex and the Single Girl. In 1965 and 66, there are tentative references to student movements and youth culture, drugs, and rock music. This is an article about marijuana, and on the second page, there is a photograph of Allen Ginsberg, not as a literary person, but as a promoter of marijuana. The beatnik poet Allen Ginsberg leading a demonstration for the legalization of marijuana. The word pot means marijuana, which they claim to be less dangerous than alcohol or tobacco. In general, the magazine is oriented towards mainstream culture, so counterculture is associated with the negative aspects of permissiveness. In general, tachydromos gives a rich overview of how American culture was gradually received in a more nuanced and ambivalent way. Both high culture and popular culture were positively, American, I mean, were positively received until 1960. The anti-communist backlash of the Karamanlis government, along with the gradual approach of the center with the left during the 1963 elections, means that American culture was not as well received and well promoted by the magazine. Although we know now that at the same time its editor, Labrakis, was in contact with the Congress for Cultural Freedom for the financing of his intellectual journal, Epoches. In the mid-60s, although American cultural texts are much less present, the social upheaval in the US is represented as a proof that the American model is not as perfect. On the other hand, periodicals of the left are negative towards American culture. The student periodical, the Πανσπουδαστική, which was partly financed by the left party, ΕΔΑ, systematically published articles on cultural issues, but did not have any reference to American culture until 1966. Then there was an article on Bob Dylan, American rock music and counterculture. This reference was justified because rock music was considered a political weapon. Moreover, the term used was not pop, but popular, so that the political role of music was accentuated. Nevertheless, as the writer of the article, Elias Karas, has told me, the article stirred reactions among the party officials. You can see there was, in the same issue, there was a report about the student movement, the American student movement. And as the dictatorship approaches, the imagery used on the cover of the magazine, 1967, combines all the stereotypes of mass American culture, showing that the dictatorship is the American enemy, the cowboy, the secret agent. If mainstream magazines have an ambivalent attitude towards mainstream American culture and magazines of the left reject it, there is an alternative channel for the transfer of American underground culture to Greece as early as 1959, which is the presence of certain beat poets. For instance, Conrad Rux, you can see him on the photograph, Gregory Corso, also on the photograph, Harold Norse, Ted Jones, Bill Barker, Alan Ansem, Philip Lamantia, John Isham, Daniel Richter, and Sinclair Bates all lived in Greece for different periods in the early to mid-60s. Allen Ginsberg arrived in Athens in 1961, meeting Nanos Valauritis, who was in the previous Prof photograph, and Spiros Meimaris, a young poet who had lived in San Francisco and had met there Lawrence Ferlinghetti. Nanos Valauritis had met Allen Ginsberg and William Burroughs in the 1950s in Paris. He introduced the beat poets to representatives of the generation of the 30s, such as Elitis and Seferis. They are the two Greek Nobel laureates, but they were somewhat skeptical towards them due to their subversive cultural practices and identity. In any case, Greek modernists such as Seferis were closer to high modernism, especially T.S. Eliot, than to 1920s surrealism, while others experimented with surrealism in the 1930s, but distanced themselves from avant-garde cultural practices. On the other hand, the beats were very well received by a small group of young bohemian artists. Two prominent members of this group was Panos Koutroubousis, here with Allen Ginsberg, and Dimitris Poulikakos. Panos Koutroubousis was an artist and writer, and Dimitris Poulikakos, poet, translator, and later became rock musician. The gallerist and little magazine editor, Leonidas Christakis, where the photograph was taken at his home, already had an underground cultural and artistic identity and aimed at the union of art with life praxis, adopting avant-garde practices. These artists were attracted by the beat's subversive performative identity, the individual search for freedom, and the spontaneity and fluidity of the beat's writing, which they associated with liberation from the rules of national modernism and socialist realism. In the politically polarized literary field of the 60s, they adopted the apolitical dissent of the beats, which allowed them to distance themselves from both sides. It is indicative that in a 1994 interview, Kutrubusi says that he did not discuss literature with Ginsberg when they met in 1961, but he describes instead his initiations to marijuana by Ginsberg. In the same interview, he refers to the beatnik era as a way of life which he adopted. Greek writers became aware of beat writing through books such as Olivia Press editions and foreign magazines such as the Evergreen Review, which could be found in Greek specialized bookshops. But the beat poet's presence played an important role in the reception of the work and the way of life among those who already had a receptive horizon of expectations. Thus, the initial reception of the beats in Greece was more focused on their way of life. This emphasis deterred the established modernist writers and the literary magazines they influenced from responding to beat writing in a positive manner. The magazines published by the Valauritis and Christakis, which were more avant-garde, played the most crucial role in the reception of the beats, addressing a limited public. Nevertheless, a representative of the established generation of the 30s who interacted with the beats and found renewed inspiration in their poetry was the prominent surrealist poet Andreas Epirikos, who in 1963 and 64 wrote many poems explicitly referring to the beats. One of them was dedicated to Konrad Rux, we have already seen him on the photographs. He also wrote the poem Beati, it is mis symorphoseos I Agii. I translate Beati from Beatus in Latin. Beati, or the saints of non-conforming, where the beats are included in a lineage of romantic and surrealist poets, along with Marx, Lenin, Kropotkin, Jesus, and Mohammed. And the poem Beat Beat Beatitude, or Beatitude, I don't know, I think it can be pronounced in both ways, and Love and Glory, which describes Jack Kerouac as the Dionysus and Apollo, bringing the sperma, the seed and semen of a new era. The interaction of the beat poets with their Greek counterparts is also obvious in the avant-garde periodicals of the period, such as Το Άλλο στην Τέχνη, Residue in English, and Πάλι. Το Άλλο στην Τέχνη was published by Christakis and brought together artists and writers from different movements close to the avant-garde. Its layout and editorial choices is avant-garde. There are no dates or page numbers in the issues. Foreign texts were not translated, and only two issues appeared. The magazine did not ignore political reality. The covers of the two issues refer to the assassinations of Labrakis, which was a Greek MP assassinated by the parastate, let's say, and Kennedy. In these two issues, the presence of the beat poets living in Greece is noticeable. They include an extract from Konrad Rux's collection of poems, Tsapakua, or the Invocation of Bran, published in Athens, and his poem Ser Selima, referring to his relationship with his wife Zina Ratsevsky. We have already seen them on the photograph of Life magazine. And Zina, here is a text more clearly, an extract. Zina is presented here in mythological terms as agave, I don't know how you pronounce it in English, but I mean the mother of the mother of Pentheus in Bacche, or Bacche, or Bacha, as a deadly female sexual force who destroys men, including her son. During her stay in Athens, Conan Drugs also wrote a manifesto for an Athenian happening, American style. The magazine also contains two poems by Bill Barkel from his collection Sunamu. And the poet Athens again is characteristic of Beat experience of modern day Athens. The poem brings together ancient features of Athens urban landscape, such as Aeolian Street, mythological references such as the Furies and Aeolus, and aspects of modern life such as the radio, snake socket exclaimed the silence of picket bulbs, and the sense of the poet's alienation. In the same issue, Ted Jones published a self-presentation that draws on avant-garde manifestos, and the aim of his presence in Greece is to bring a bit of US culture unofficially, to bring a happening, to wake up the dull intellectuals and to disturb the non-creators. Happenings, drawing on the Dada legacy, were a new phenomenon flourishing in American and European art circles at the time. American beat writers living in Greece and their Greek counterparts regarded happenings as a way of attacking parochial Greek culture. Indeed, the first happening in Athens took place in a cafe in 1963, organized by Poulikakos and Koutribousis on the picture here, where texts by William Burroughs and Jack Kerouac were read out loud. Greek writers such as Christakis, Valaoritis, and Empirikos closely associated beat writing with European avant-garde movements and above all, surrealism. The grouping together of beats and the European avant-garde shows how the 1920s movements shaped the horizon of expectations of the Greek artists. Reciprocally, the reception of the beats in Greece happens at the time when they were most interested in the European avant-garde. In any case, the reception of beats detoured through Paris, both literally, because they came from Paris to Greece, and metaphorically. I move on to another little magazine, a Greek one of the left, Martyries, by a group of dissident young intellectuals of the left, which they rejected socialist realism. And it is the only magazine of their left which refers to beat poetry until 67, until the dictatorship, that is. Here we see a translation of Allen Ginsberg's American poem, and an article by Manolis Labridis, Angry Youth, or Look Back in Anger, it can be translated, but it refers to the play, and which describes the American youth's rejection of the consumerist society as a symptom of the crisis of capitalism. But the article notes that the beat poetry is contradictory because it descends without action and associates their chaotic writing with the lack of a correct worldview, and I quote. On the other hand, it characterizes Ginsberg's poem interesting. Moving on to the perception of Greece in the poetry of the beats, I will focus on certain characteristic poems. Many of these texts portray the beats' experience of Greece, such as the coexistence of the classical past with the present, on their drifting in a pre-modern space while seeking a spiritual experience, in many cases aided by experimentation with drugs. Thus, the American beat poets experience Greece within its cultural double cultural bind. On one hand, they viewed its modern reality through the classical past. And I think that Gregory Corso here on this poem, which is dedicated to Bill Barker, we saw him before, presents this double binding very characteristically, giving this love and hate relationship of modern Greece with ancient Greece. As many philhellenes before them, they were worried that the reality of present-day Greece might disappoint them, Corso, in another poem on Palatine, this is the end of the poem, says, I'll never see things as they are, debauched of dream, I have an eye impure for sight, I dare not visit Greece, because he's afraid of this clash between the ideal and reality. On the other hand, the element of tradition, which made the country the pre-modern space that allowed their free movement and personal freedom, by the same token made it a parochial, cultural and social environment, which they aimed to alter through their presence, we saw Ted Jones before, and cultural identity and practices. In this respect, they adopted the Orientalist view of Greece. Residue was a little magazine published in Greece by the Beats living in Greece. So it was published in English. The first issue was published in Athens. And here are the contents. And it includes their Greek connection, Nanos Valaoritis. A little magazine published in Athens in English allowed these poets more freedom in terms of references to drugs and homosexuality. And it was a strategy already adopted by Christakis 2 years ago, which he chose not to translate Rook's poem, which referred to drug experience. The most prominent example of how Greek culture is viewed is, of course, Allen Ginsberg's Sea Battle of Salamis took place off Perama, which was published in Residue. And this creates an interplay between the atmosphere of the present-day Athens working-class neighborhood, Greek and American pop culture, and the classical past. This interplay leads to the poet to a spiritual experience only he among the present can appreciate. And I'm referring here, it's Negro voices screaming 100 years back in striped pants, pink shirts, patent leather shoes, and their lean dog feet. They are jumping, enjoying this minute over the bones of Persian sailors. The news are loose in the world again with their big black voices and bouzouki blues. Bouzouki is the traditional Greek music, of course. And he also refers to Tsitsanis and Γιατί δεν με θες, etc. So the association of the Beat generation with the classical tradition has recently drawn critical attention. While Gregory Corso is the most prominent case, Ginsberg's poem shows how classical and mythical tradition is adopted to be rewritten according to Beat cultural hierarchies, where pop culture is equally important to classical tradition, and the poet is therefore not disappointed. Modern Greek youths doesn't sing to popular Greek music, seem as they have stepped off from a Greek vase paintings. Ginsberg here only allusively refers to another element of classical tradition which he is attracted to, which is nudity of male bodies and homosexuality. The connection is much clearer in the poem Acropolis, like any Golgotha, which is from the journals of Ginsberg, written at the same time during his stay in Greece. There, the ancient male sculptures are eroticized, and the Acropolis is viewed as an object, a backdrop of his erotic adventures with male sexual partners he has to pay. The poet is disappointed because the comparison of the idealized homoerotic relationships between Socrates and Alcibiades and Achilles and Patroclus are not equaled by reality, where he is regarded as an American gentleman who pays for sexual favors. Although he is attracted to the liberty which Greek men touch each other because it's a much more tactile culture, he feels that he's excluded from that since he is a stranger, a Westerner. Here the Orientalist hierarchy is reversed since the Westerner feels estranged and taken advantage of. Moreover, within the framework of a traditional concept of sexuality, which existed in Greece at the time, homosexual relations are not within the classical framework of Erastes and Eromenos, lover and loved one, but between a masculine and an effeminate male, which also place him in a reverse hierarchy. This brings us to another characteristic which has drawn scholar attention recently, i.e. the character of the beat's translational experiences. While they rejected the homogenized American culture and the Cold War politics, the beats enjoyed in some cases the privileges of their nationality, while in other cases they aimed to subvert the American politics through avant-garde internationalism, for example, the cooperating with the Greek artists and writers. The view of Greece, as in the case with other pre-modern spaces such as Mexico or Tangiers, as a space of transgression, which involves drugs, the extensive references to LSD in residue is indicative, and transgressive sexual practices, and we can include here Lamantia's poem, which there are images of two Lolitas of 8 and 9, also with transgressive textual practices on the level of form and content, since there is no danger of obscenity trials for English magazines in Greece. It is an ambivalent view that amalgamates privilege and political aims. Finally, the permissiveness of the Greek government towards the drug use seems to have ended during the politically turbulent 1965. There was a coup by the Greek king who overthrew the Greek government, and there were a series of a very turbulent time. This led to the departure of most of the Greek community. The second issue of Residue, published in London in 66, includes narratives of persecution and imprisonment in Greek jails, as was the case with the first issue, which included a poem written in a Tangiers prison. To conclude, Beats view Greece through different lenses. The strongest one is the textual and cultural lens of classical tradition. The empirical space and the cultural practices of the modern inhabitants of the country are always viewed through the symbolic and textual lens of the classical past. In some cases, as is the case with traditional Philhellenism, this leads to a disappointment. While in other cases, the present is viewed as equally valid to the past, since the traditional cultural taxonomies are subverted, as is the case in Ginsberg's poem, Sea Battle of Salamis, took place off Perama. In other cases, Greece becomes a heterotopia, where neither the classical ruins nor the present lives up to the expectations. The second lens is that of Orientalism, with sexual permissiveness, authenticity, and on the other side, exploitation of the Westerner. Finally, Greece also becomes the site of political and cultural subversion through the union of life with art praxis. The cooperation of the American and the Greek writers and artists in both the Greek and English language avant-garde periodicals, the translations, the renewed interest in surrealism in both groups shows the shared interests and the political dynamics they recognized in this cooperation. Thank you very much for your attention.